it's a very hospitable place, and it's a festival that uniquely manages to put its imprint on a whole city, which is very hard when it's a big city like this. And the chance to screen at a open air venue like here with 3,500 people is a very unique experience. So, and very nice people, nice festival. Easy to say yes when you're invited. Yeah, that's a very rare experience for somebody who's used to be behind the camera, absolutely. And I almost regret not having taken a picture of just, you know, being up there, of what I was seeing as opposed to what seeing me up there. That's not so interesting, but it's a moment to cherish because it's, you know, the fact that, you know, regardless of whether it's my film or somebody else's, the fact that 3,500 people sit down at night outside to watch a movie is really a testament to the attraction that film can have, you know. And that, I think, is in itself something, you know, anybody involved with film should experience. It's just a really terrific experience. Yeah, you know, the moment you say yes, then also partly having been here before, you start thinking about how this will resonate here as opposed to somewhere else. Partly because of its history, the part of you know, being you know, mixed ethnic groups, etc. And but I think I've experienced here before that people are quite generous in accepting politically incorrect or other points of views, and are not terribly self-righteous, you know. So I'm actually looking forward to this Q&A or this conversation later today, where you hear some of the responses to it, because I don't think I anticipated being hostile, and but it's probably the theme of, you know, of a Muslim policeman and a really misanthropic human being together in a car discussing the validity or not of faith, it might be something that resonates with an audience here. I think, you know, when you make a thriller or action film or comedy or whatever, the audience always has some expectations. So in this genre, if the film didn't fulfill on that level, I think an audience will be, you know, disappointed. But that being said, there's no reason why you cannot use a genre to explore issues or have a theme which is outside of what normally is discussed in a thriller format, you know. And that's one of the things that attracted me to this, is that it is, in many ways, a chance to look at the sort of parallel existences that we have in Europe today, you know, and the religious, the deeply religious people in this film are not Muslim, they are Christians. They're benign human beings, but they are certainly outside of the mainstream and are just as disenfranchised from the mainstream as a lot of Muslim communities feel in places in Europe, because they're not being recognized as having valid point of views in terms of politics or upbringing with children or whatever. But you know, I think that's why a film like this also resonates with a European audience now, because we all feel that dilemma, which is that yes, we have a very civilized and very broad common understanding of good and bad, but what do we do with all the people that don't feel disenfranchised, that don't feel like they're part of that mainstream? Are we just going to shun them and push them off and say they're wrong? Or are we going to recognize that there's a place for them in the society as well? We usually make the big mistake of thinking that evil is something that is, you know, firmly implanted in other human beings. And but being bad is, you know, a capacity that is within all of us, you know. And for me, it was interesting to tell a story about people who, number one, somebody who had lost his faith in life having any sort of purpose or meaning, and which is really a terrible thing for a human being, I think, to lose its sense of purpose, except for work, which is, you know, in itself probably insufficient. But also the you know, this religious sect, if you will, which is placed on the countryside of Denmark, they represent in many ways something I think is quite common in Europe today, which is people who felt that they were part of society and part of the fabric of a system, and who have been disenfranchised because the countryside does not provide enough votes for the, you know, urban politicians. Farming is no longer done by, you know, small, medium-sized farms. It's being done by industrial, you know, all of the things that EU has brought with it in terms of larger scale, more bigger systems, which has alienated a lot of people. And you see this not just in Europe. You see this resonates the same thing in the United States, is that the globalization or the larger structures have made some people feel very small. And in the fact that these people have flocked to sort of you know, firebrand sect, and it happens to be Christian, could be just the same as some kids in a ghetto in Brussels or in Paris listening to you know, a clergyman in their mosque. You know, I don't think it's a very big difference in the mechanisms of it. When you lay your life in the hands of somebody, either in love or in terms of saying, I put my hands in the hands of God, for instance, you are always vulnerable, especially to being manipulated by people who prey on that vulnerability. And we see throughout the history of church, throughout the history of religion, cynical human beings who exploit the deep-rooted faith of others. I'll just give you an example that a lot of parents in Molenbeek in Belgium were explaining how they were trying to keep the children away from this guy who was recruiting, you know, I forget his name, but who had for the years been sort of the big daddy of that community, were giving money to kids, and these, you know, petty criminal guys who had lost any possibility of having a future in Belgian society were, you know, were included, and they didn't even have to be deeply faithful. He said, it's okay you drink as long as you do something important for the cause, you know. So I think that's one of the, I think religion in itself is not a problem, but I think the institutions and the people who exploit religion has been a big problem as long as religion has existed, you know. And that's one of the dichotomies of being a human being, is that you cannot love and you cannot give your self to other human being without laying your heart open, you know. I have a Viking project with Zentrupa, which is, I wouldn't call it a comedy, but it has a very unique look at, and a very Scandinavian look. It's at the period of Vikings. It doesn't trade on the usual cliches of those guys. which I hope we will be shooting next year. And I have two other projects that I also right now competing for, you know, maybe going this winter. I think that the fact that a film has a beginning and a middle and an end is some of the attraction to it, because it forces you to say, this is what I want to say, this is where I want it to begin, and this is how I want to leave the audience, you know. It's a discipline in it, but it's also a fundamental of storytelling. Once you've told your punchline or revealed the secret or whatever it is that your story contains, then that's where you choose to leave an audience. A miniseries could have the same thing, and that's attractive that you're allowed to explore in depth characters and a story or a universe. So that I'm very much attracted to. I think the series that has as an ambition to run season after season, they are very well made and they're well written and terrific actors, so there's nothing wrong. I mean, it's the same people essentially that make movies, but the ambition in those series is primarily to keep you attached and addicted, and we all get addicted. So the impulse is not to lead an audience to a conclusion and a point where you say, and this is what I meant by leading you to the or telling you this tale, you know. And that's a whole different, that's a business model and not storytelling, you know.